Erik Brynjolfsson. Cellist, Yo-Yo Ma. Cellist, Yo-Yo Ma. And your moderator, Chief Technology Correspondent, Axios, Ina Fried.
Ina! Well, I'm really excited. I think we're in for a treat, not just because of the two panelists that are here, but I think the question that we're taking on in this discussion and the next one that we'll have is a really crucial one. I just got back from the TED conferences. I know Eric did, and you know, really that was the same question was at the heart of TED, which is, you know, we're creating this path with technology. Are we creating more challenges? Are we creating more risks than we're solving with technology? We have an incredibly diverse group of people that are gonna try and answer this question and bring with it very different perspectives. But it's not a question that's just for the tech industry or just for the students or just for the academics to solve. It's really a question that we as a society are gonna have to grapple with. And really to set the stage, Eric, for this discussion, I think it's important. We all see the headlines, the robots are coming for your jobs, AI is gonna take over the world. I think it is really important that we understand where really is AI and robots? Where are the sectors that they are going to displace current jobs that exist? Where are the new jobs going to come from? Talk about where we are today, because people think that this is a future thing. Actually, artificial intelligence is already displacing in some fields like tax preparers and stuff. Talk about where we are now and then where we're headed in the very short-term future.
You want me to go with that?
Yeah.
So, thanks for asking. I view this as the biggest question for our society over the coming decade, the role of technology and the way it's going to reshape the economy and jobs. And as you're saying, it's already having a huge effect. There's a lot of hype around it as well, because there is when these big changes happen. And so first, let me just briefly say what it's not. We're not facing the end of work. It's not that robots are going to take all the jobs anytime soon. You know, maybe someday, I hope someday, actually, so that we can have lives of leisure. But we are facing some really serious crises in many parts of the country and many parts of the world, because machines are affecting work at a scale and scope and speed that they never have before. You mentioned some of the tax preparers and other kinds of routine information processing work. That's very much in the bullseye. Any kind of routine, repetitive work can increasingly be done not just by physical robots, but by information processing robots. And this is something that's been unfolding really over the past couple of decades, information technology is affecting big sections of the economy, not always entire jobs, but very frequently tasks within jobs, these repetitive tasks within jobs. And it shows up in the economic statistics quite strikingly. Although wages grew for a couple hundred years after the Industrial Revolution, we're now about 30 times wealthier than our ancestors were a couple hundred years ago. The past 20 years or so, 15 to 20 years, median wages have stagnated. That is, the wages of the person right in the middle of the income distribution is flat or fallen a little bit. People with high school education or less have seen their wages absolutely fall, even adjusting for inflation in real terms. And this is causing a crisis not just in economics, with the labor share falling, the labor force participation rate falling, but also in a lot of social indicators are very troubling. Ann Case and Angus Deaton have documented a really troubling turnaround in deaths from despair, as they call it. Fewer and fewer Americans have been dying for most of the century, for most of the past century, the 20th century. But in this century, we're seeing more suicides, more drug abuse, more alcoholism, more of these categories called deaths from despair among that group whose wages are also following. Now, it's a little early to say exactly how these are all causally related, but more and more economists, including me, are coming to the conclusion that technology is creating a bigger overall pie, creating more wealth than ever before, but it's leading to more uneven distribution of that pie, more inequality.
So we may get a chance to get back to death and despair, but I wanna, if we can, turn for just a moment to what are the jobs of the future gonna look like? And I think this'll relate and we'll start to understand why we asked the world's foremost cellist to be here. What types of skills are gonna be necessary for the jobs of the future? If we're not doing sort of the information processing that's formed the core of the white-collar jobs.
So let me say, it's not all information processing. It's routine information processing, repetitive information processing that have been hit the hardest. So what we're seeing is that a good rule of thumb is you want to be doing work that machines can't do well. And machines right now are not very good at creative work, like Yo-Yo is. They're not very good at complex problem solving, at planning, a lot of the leadership skills. Another big category that machines are still quite bad at are interpersonal skills. So coaching, nurturing people, advising, motivating people, leadership, teamwork, negotiations, sales. Those are all categories where interpersonal skills are really, really important. And it's not just somebody with high IQ who can do the creative task, but also people with high EQ, emotional intelligence, that can connect. That those types of skills are becoming more in demand, and we're seeing growing numbers of jobs for people with those skills, and growing pay for people with those kinds of skills. And for the next decade or so, we'll continue to see machines performing very poorly in those two broad categories.
So yeah, if you know, a lot of people tend to look at this debate and, you know, they tend to say there's, you know, information jobs and productivity workers over here and creative people over here. And I think that's not the way you look at it. Can you talk a little bit about how you see the role of creative people and artisans and technologists and scientists? You don't see it as a divide. You see all those things as similar in fundamental nature.
Well, you know, I think by nature, human beings are creative people. That's how we've evolved, yeah. And that's how and hopefully we will continue to evolve. And creativity is not exclusive to any discipline. We invented disciplines, essentially. And there's creativity everywhere. From a child, my daughter just gave birth to her son, and you can already see the interaction, who needs what, when, and how do you express it, pre-language. So I would say business is incredibly creative. But the question is, for me, whenever there's something new that's invented, it goes through lots of, bumps in order to figure out what the human condition will do with it. Is there bad? Is there good? You know, that's part of the subject of this talk.
Yes.
I think it's not the technology that we need to worry about. It's us.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, how well do we understand ourselves? I'm 61. I'm still trying to figure it out. And because we all take part in the cycle of life and death, and in between, I feel nobody escapes. We all go through love, we cry, we are joyful, and we die, and we all lose our parents, right? So how do we do that? That's not about machines. And so we need to figure out what we're here for, and of course it's great that we have robots, but the robots are not humans. Yes, they can do all these things, but they don't wonder. They don't necessarily suffer, but it's experience, our life experience, that makes, with warts and all, that makes us who we are. And that's what we treasure in one another, I think.
Erik, are there areas of your field of economics and of technology that are starting to grapple and really get this idea that the human component of what they do is shifting? Are we, I guess a shorter, simpler way, are we well prepared for the world that's changing in front of us?
I don't think we're very well prepared. It goes back to just the way we measure the economy, GDP. Robert Kennedy once eloquently pointed out that GDP misses most of what we really value in our economy, our poetry, love, and connection with other people. None of that stuff is measured in the GDP. The good news is, as John Maynard Keynes, a famous economist, pointed out almost 100 years ago, he was describing a world where machines would increasingly do more and more of the repetitive work, like I just described, more and more of all types of work, and that would free us up to spend more time doing some of the things that Yo-Yo was describing, interacting with each other. If we could take, as John Maynard Keynes said, solve the economic problem and make sure that we had the productive capacity to have enough food, clothing, shelter for everybody, then that would be a world where we could spend more time on those creative areas. And I couldn't agree more with what Yo-Yo said, that I think most people love being creative. I mean, you take a three-year-old and you put him, a set of blocks in front of him or her, the first thing they do is they start building things, they start creating things, you give them a crayon, they start drawing things. We all love to create, and unfortunately, many of our businesses, many of our companies, many of our schools spend a lot of time trying to stamp that creativity out so that they can do these more repetitive kinds of tasks. But I think economists, especially, need to start thinking about how we can create value and conceive of value much more broadly than the narrow mechanistic approach that is embodied in our GDP. And as in business, as in government, you tend to get what you measure. And if we're measuring only the narrow productive side, we're going to be missing out on a lot of what gives value to life.
Yeah, how prepared do you think we are for the future?
When were we ever prepared for the future? I think one of the great issues we're facing along is the idea that there's change that's happening that is even more of an unprecedented scale than during the first Industrial Revolution.
That's right.
So, and I think we see in our world a lot of people responding to this change with an incredible amount of unease and fear. And what happens when people are afraid, what happens to a turtle, you go into your shell.
And we were talking about this a little backstage, because I think we saw just a glimmer of this in the recent elections, both here and some of the elections abroad, where we're sort of at the very early stages, from what I take from what Erik said, of how automation, how artificial intelligence will reshape our economy. We're at the very beginnings of that. Similarly, we haven't talked about climate change, but we seem to be at the very beginnings of the environmental impacts that we're going to feel. These changes could be dramatic, and yet already our fear has kicked in. It seems like that's your sense as well. What role can the arts play in making us more resilient, helping us deal with change? I know that's something you think a lot about.
Well, I think that one of the things, we have incredible tools. And in fact, when we have, I think of arts and sciences as part of the engine of culture. Beauty and truth, not so bad,
mm-hmm.
Right?
No.
But sometimes, I think artists, scientists, it doesn't even have to be people in those professions, can play the part of being a scout to society. You mentioned climate change. So there are so many factors involved in measuring climate change. But how do we know that it's true? Do we have enough trust to believe the person that reports here is what's happening? And is there an unbroken line that we can trust to say, okay, you're a scout, you found this out, you're telling me this is true, so let's prepare just in case, right? It's better to prepare just in case rather than say, whoops, we got the wrong data.
That used to be, I thought, it was nearing consensus opinion. It's now become a debatable subject. Do you feel like, I hear a lot from people that, they feel like the world is turned upside down a little bit. Are there factors that you think are stabilizing in this, or is this all that's going on in our political climate a reflection of how humans are adjusting to a changing world?
Well, there's a false way to stabilize it, which is to think we can go back to the way things were before.
But we're going to create these beautiful, clean coal jobs.
I think there's a dangerous myth going around that we can restore the kind of economy that we had before. And for a lot of people, that was, at least in their rose-colored glasses, that was an ideal world. But the reality is America or any successful country has never thrived by trying to lock in place the status quo. We've always been a country of change, of entrepreneurship, of turbulence, Joseph Schumpeter called it creative destruction. And the only way to thrive is to embrace change. And that is a kind of constant, is this constant change. The data I looked at was not just that we have rapid change in technology, but to my surprise, when I first looked at the data, we actually have not very rapid change in our ability to adjust to it. There's less mobility in the United States than there used to be, both geographic and between different groups. There's less turbulence in terms of new job creation, new business creation, and all of these things are tending to stagnate a little bit. And that's where the real damage occurs, is when we have a mismatch between rapidly changing technology and not rapidly changing skills, jobs, opportunities, industries. So the answer actually is not to try to freeze and slow things down. It's perhaps paradoxically the opposite. It's to have more flexibility in our economy, be able to adjust more quickly so that people can flow to where the new jobs are, entrepreneurs can create new industries. If we do that, then we'll have as many new opportunities as the old ones that are being eliminated. Sad to say, over the past 15 to 20 years, that's not been what's happening, but a lot of the policies that try to slow down change will actually make things worse.
You know, Eric, if I can just jump in on to Eric's point, it's like I think sometimes we measure big things, and we forget to look at what's happening at the local level. Mm-hmm. Two interesting ideas that came up recently, and one of them was that I was working with a very talented designer who happens to be from the state of Michigan. Right? And he was saying, you know, there's been an exodus of people from Michigan, they're all going to the big city, and what about the idea of if one person who's a trusted guy from a community thinks back from his big city and says, what can I do to help that community? Because they know me. Mm-hmm. They know what I do. And let's say you get support for that. The bang for the buck is so much more than, you know.
Yeah.
So on a,
it requires that kind of trust that you
right, exactly.
About.
Because you can't build trust by having an agency come in and says, okay, now we're going to do this. Mm-hmm. That works less well. And for the longest time, we're talking about Art Basel, right? So there's this, happened by accident, I saw Wynwood Walls, which is a development by the late Tony Goldman, where he took these warehouses in a derelict section of town.
This is
in Miami, that's right, and had street artists paint all the walls. It's now known as Wynwood Walls. It's the site where Art Basel comes. It's a throbbing, thriving night spot, and a million visitors go and visit every year. Now imagine these places became actually places where artists, NGOs, social agency can work. You can actually increase efficiency so much more that actually to enable children or single mothers to have their children be exposed to all the types of things that her employer's children are exposed to.
This is such an important point, that there are lots of opportunities to create a much more inclusive kind of a world going forward, and the technology can actually be used to enable that going forward. I mean, a couple of examples that came out of a competition we recently held. I think you'll be hearing about it on Wednesday from Devin Cook, the Inclusive Innovation Competition Challenge. But one is a company called 99 Degrees Custom, and it's located not far from here up in Lowell, Massachusetts, but in other ways a world apart, because Lowell is an old mill town. It calls itself the birthplace of the American Industrial Revolution, and one time was thriving, but for the past almost 100 years has been on a downward trajectory. A lot of people struggling. All the old mills have been shut down because low-cost labor throughout the rest of the world has been able to outcompete them on just a pure wage basis. But now some of the jobs are coming back because a company like 99 Degrees Custom has introduced some new technologies that allow for much more flexible textile production, but they require much more flexible workers with more skills, and they end up getting paid higher wages. Now, they're not the tens or hundreds of thousands of mill jobs that we used to have, but they are a fairly decent number of jobs paying higher wages than before, and the skills that are involved, the creativity that's involved, and creativity doesn't have to be, inventing a new iPhone, it can be helping with new designs. There's lots of different types of creativity. That's been an example of how the technology has been leveraged with a more skilled workforce to create more inclusive innovation and more jobs going forward.
And that's kind of the piece that I think came out of some of the talks at TED too, that, you know, oftentimes it's pitted at this thing, will the computer have the job, will the human have the job, and we're ignoring what could be the best case scenario, which is that we leverage the strengths of both. And I think Garry Kasparov, the chess player, was talking about how, you know, it turned out if you took the best computer or the best chess player, you didn't have the optimal thing. What you needed was a pretty good chess player that was able to understand what the computer was good at, but humble enough to know what the computer was good at, skilled enough to see the gaps in its strategy, and that combination was what was best suited.
Well, that's exactly right. And to underscore that point, you know, Garry Kasparov, as most of you probably know, is a 13th chess champion. He was defeated by Deep Blue, a computer, but after he was defeated, he created this freestyle chess where you had humans and machines working together, and they could defeat the best machine or the best human. And it was really that kind of teamwork, exactly as you were describing, that turned out to be important in building these hybrids that were effective.
And didn't he try to re-challenge Deep Blue, and they said no?
To be clear, I think it was IBM's executives, not the computer, was like totally down with it.
No. Well, that's right.
Deep Blue was like, bring it.
But why did they say no? Why did the executive say no?
No, they'd gotten all this great, publicity. And I think
once you win, you don't want to.
No. But actually, there is another point. I mean, I think Garry Kasparov also would argue that, and this is another perhaps a paradoxical point. Once he lost, actually, that was in some ways the best thing that ever happened to him. It was not the end of human chess playing. Chess became more popular, and last year, AlphaGo beat the Go champion, and I've never seen so many people at MIT and elsewhere buy Go boards and start playing Go. So humans love to compete against other humans. They love to play these games, and the fact that a race car can run faster than Carl Lewis, or that a Deep Blue can play chess super well, that doesn't mean that we don't still get a lot of joy from interacting with each other, playing sports, playing games, and doing that human connection. It's something very different than just the mechanics of moving chess pieces.
You know, backstage we were talking about how we got into each of our fields, and one of the things that we said that, you know, very often it's a teacher, sometime, someplace.
Yeah, most of us.
And
yeah, that's
my wife used to say to our children, you know, there's no boring subject, they're just boring people, and so I actually think from working at various ways that in fact. I agree with my wife, which is actually good for survival, but it's also really good for thinking, in the sense that if you go deep enough into anything, you find the world. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't matter what you do. And so far, I think if we measure things at the large scale, you miss out on that specific way of learning. What is your interest? How can you go as deep as you can and figure things out? And that's something, you know, that's why we have people who want to make things, right? This great scientist that is making furniture because it gives so much pleasure. No wonder, pleasure, those are our, they belong
human,
to
human
us.
Human traits, yeah.
And the other thing it seems like we are missing too is there's not much that we're nostalgic for that technology has replaced. It either has lived on as an artisan craft, whether it's darkroom photography, all these things that computers can do maybe better, but still not as creatively. Or we look back and say, thank goodness it freed us up to do X. I mean, maybe there's some unemployed horses out there, but you know, short of that, I think most of the human repetitive tasks that have been replaced, in general, once we've gotten through it, we've been pretty happy, right, Eric?
Well, I think that's exactly right. I think it's a very fortunate thing that the kinds of things that machines are particularly good at are mostly things we don't really like. You know, the more dangerous, dirty, repetitive, less creative tasks. And most of us enjoy doing creative work and interpersonal work. And by some fortuitous coincidence, those are exactly the things machines are not very good at that humans are good at. So it's a nice division of labor.
Does that mean that, Eric, you do not like your handcrafted tires on your car?
handcrafted tires. No, I don't need any handcrafted tire. In fact, it's very ironic that I just brought my car in yesterday because even my mass-produced tires aren't always as good as they could be. Uh-huh. But I'd love to have that stuff just taken off the equation. Like, I wouldn't have to think about that anymore, and we could spend more time listening to the cello or telling stories or just interacting with each other over a glass of wine.
So this is a discussion that we're going to be having over the next 3 days. And, you know, this is a discussion that's going to continue. It's a really important one for our society. We're going to have some more speakers in a little bit. But one of the things I do at TED, and I really enjoy to try and get us thinking differently, is to bring in some of these disciplines. So we're not just hearing words, but we're watching arts and hearing music. I understand you might have a cello backstage.
Yeah.
Well, we'd love to hear you play.
Come on. Is there a cello? Cello!
Oh, you wanted to play it. I thought Eric was going to play it, but if you want to play it.
Oh, you got one too?
Oh, wow. Okay.
All right, I'll let you do this one.
All right. Thanks, it's great to see you.
All right,
a pleasure.
Thank you so much, thank you. So, so someone's going to bring me a cello. Jessica's going to bring me a cello. I'm going to use this, don't worry. Okay, all right. So, so I'm going to play you like three short things by one composer, Bach, because he wrote for cello alone, but three different states of mind. So think of it as joy, internal thinking, and wonder. Because I think that's one of the things music actually allows us to go into a different state. So as a musician, I can go into that state that the music asks me to do, or vice versa. So hopefully, you might agree, and then we can talk a little bit further. So joy, inner self, and wonder. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. So, thank you so much. First of all, I just want to thank you so much for inviting me to come here. What's a cellist doing at Solve? You might be wondering. Well, I first heard of Solve only a couple of months ago when I was lucky enough to have dinner with President Reif. I was so impressed that MIT would dedicate its time, brains, and networks to solving the most intractable problems for society and to getting people all over the world involved in this. I believe strongly that the arts, alongside science and technology, are important collaborators in this important mission. And I'm very, very glad that President Reif, Alex Amuyel, and her team agree. It's always good to agree. No. Working together with the folks at Solve, we've written four additional challenges for 2017 to 2018, asking people like you to propose arts and culture-based solutions that will address the same problems. We are challenging you to do the following. One, in youth skills and workforce, find an innovative learning technology, educational model, tool, or strategy that connects passion for the arts and culture to 21st century skills. Two, in sustainable urban communities, create a replicable urban community space that can be both a source for food and water and a vehicle for messaging about their sustainable production and consumption. Three, in brain health, find a non-medical intervention that uses the arts and culture to reduce stress and enhance brain fitness and resiliency among resource-limited populations. And last but not least, in women and technology, propose an arts and culture-based intervention that uses technology to connect women and girls to the creative economy. One of the great things about life is that I get to meet a lot of really interesting people, and I am pledging to assemble a team of mentors in the arts and sciences and elsewhere to mentor up to three teams who submit solutions in these areas. We'll tailor the group to the answers. So thank you again for participating, and we're really excited to see what comes of this. Thank you, all of you. It's really great to be here. Thank you. See you soon.